Download the one-page Spotlight app for artists.
Hello and welcome to In the Spotlight. One-page Spotlight began with a vision to encourage the creative community around the world. Creativity is all around us in big and small ways. It all depends on you as to how you nurture it and give it wings. We at One-Page Spotlight thrive to do exactly that. So we are a social media platform for artists, creators, and entertainers. If you're a dancer, singer, flutist, or even a filmmaker, One-Page Spotlight is the platform for you. Today, we're pleased to have Jyoti Kapoor Das. She is a writer, director, and also an editor. Both her offerings, Plus Minus and Chutney, have garnered raw reviews from audience, and both of them have also won Filmfare Awards. She is an FTII alumni. She's also worked with VCOM 18, where she's been the creative head of blockbuster movies like Bhaag Milkha Bhaag, Queen, and Kahani. So we're pleased to have this multifaceted woman with us. How are you, ma'am?
I'm okay. I'm just like super busy, so I've made Shraddha's life hell. But that's her karma, I don't know what she's done.
Ma'am, can you tell us a little bit about your childhood and how was it to grow with a twin brother?
Growing up with a twin brother was great because we could basically tell a lot of stories to people who would ask, you know, oh, do you think alike and do you have telepathy and harp? And we used to say, yeah, usko maar padti hai, tum mere ko lagti hai. So I think filmy thing started. So I'm quite, I think it's just pure luck that I have a twin brother and we could do all these idiotic things. But it was fun. Yeah, it's different. It makes you special. People, of course, people are still, you know, they don't remember the bio they study in school. A boy child and a girl child can't be identical twins because basically identical twins share the same. But they, you know, we still get asked, oh, are you identical? And I'll be like,
what does you answer to them then? When they ask you a question like that, what do you say?
I tell them, go back and study 8th standard bio. I just say, jaake padh lo wapas. So yeah. Matlab, it's like, yaar, kya hi hai? But it's okay, it's fun. Yeah. It's nice having a twin. It's awesome, kind of special. Man. So yeah.
I also happened to read that you really enjoyed reading Amar Chitra Katha, Spider-Man and other stories as a child. So did you take any inspiration from those stories and were you tagged as a nerd when you were a child?
Okay, so first, I don't think it's a nerd. I think we used to just love reading because we didn't have phones to kind of, you know, distract us. So that is cool. I feel very, very bad for kids today because they don't even get a chance probably to read really unless their parents push them. And, you know, even then, I don't know how they stand up to peer pressure because there's games and there's all kinds of stuff. But I think everything that you read or everything that you see in terms of, you know, stuff that you've seen on TV or films or books that you've read or experiences that you have, everything kind of comes together when you're telling stories on your own, because unless you've had those experiences somewhere and from there your imagination grows and kind of takes you forward, you wouldn't be able to tell the stories convincingly, you know. You'd just be faking it. So obviously people and audiences are really smart and they've always been really smart, so they give you a feedback immediately. So even an outrageously unreal story like an Amar Akbar Anthony, which is so strange when you look at it, but there's obviously some seed of truth in it, which led to so many people really loving the film when it came out. So I'm saying, even if it's something crazy, or today if you take, you know, compare it to the fantasy films or the, you know, all the Marvel or DC films or all the Harry Potters that you're seeing, which is a modern version of all the fantasy films or fantasy books that we've read, that also needs to be told with some seed of conviction, and that needs to have some emotion that people will feel, you know. So if someone can feel for a child who's an orphan and who's had a bad childhood and then some heroic aspect of his personality and fights against evil, that's a thing which kind of just stands. And then you take the same, whether it's Harry Potter, it's Batman, both are really the same, right? They both are orphans, they both stood against evil and they have superpowers or secret powers. So it's really the same story that you just keep hearing again and again and again. And people like those stories. So yeah, it's been nice that I could read a lot. So.
That was very well put, ma'am. Knowledge is very important. And like ma'am suggested, I would request everyone, whoever is watching it, if you have kids at home, encourage them to read more. So a good reader becomes a good storyteller, like ma'am rightly put it. So I would like to ask you, ma'am, you are an FTII alumina, and how did that help you to, reach where you are today?
So when I went to FTII, it was a very different time. We didn't have access. If anybody wanted to learn filmmaking, it was very difficult to get into the business and learn. Because it wasn't structured. The whole director relationships and all the dynamics, they were very different from what they are now. Very, very, very different. Really, very different. I can't even begin. But so that was really the only way that if you wanted to learn to do filmmaking, you would get into it and do it. And so we were shown a lot of films. We were given footage to work on. We did all our exercises on 35 and 16 film stock. That really is a discipline in itself, which today, because we have phones, because we have unlimited, cards in which we can just keep putting like as much data as we want in like TBs, forget GBs. So it somewhere leads to a little less preparation. You're kind of like, theek hai na, theek nahi ho gaya, toh aur ek baar kar lenge. Which to me is kind of a little, I'm like, nahi yaar, do your homework and then get on set so that then instead of doing a retake because you've done some stupid mistake which you needn't have done because you prepared, you're actually probably doing a retake just to better maybe a performance, or suddenly you're inspired to take a shot in a different way and you have an alternative. You're using that time and that footage for other things which might be better than just because you've not prepared enough and you're just careless and indisciplined is what. So one of the things that really, when I went to the FTII, today, of course, everyone's working on offline formats and stuff. So I don't know care that they're taking, how they're thinking about what stuff, how much they're going to shoot and how they're going to shoot. We literally could not shoot beyond a certain amount. You could not. The ratio of NG takes to OK takes had to be just that much, depending on how many shots you have in a film. So it's, I think it was a great discipline. Apart from that though, today, I don't know how much I would advise any kid who wants to get into a non-technical field, basically direction, to go to the institute, because you get much better training outside. If you are lucky enough to get mentored or to work with a director who's ready, willing, and able to teach you. It's much better to work and then learn today. Of course, not for any of the technical, not for cinematography, not for editing, not for sound recording, not for writing, but for direction, yes. Because you have everything to do, all your exercises, you have your phones and your DSLRs. So every kid today has that, and they have editing software on their phones and their laptops. So they don't need to go to a film school to learn it. Everything on YouTube, people are putting out videos of filmmaking videos, training videos. It's just, it just saves your time, saves your
energy.
Also, I think it just not really energy. You're using the same energy in doing this. It just gives you more freedom to learn the way you want to learn. It's just it's much more open university kind of concept.
Mom, when did it occur to you that you wanted to become a writer?
It never occurred to me. It just happened to me, actually. I don't think one thinks of, especially in fields of art, we don't think of, and I don't mean art like this very grand art. I'm saying art like I won't say humanities, because there's a lot of other subjects that come in humanities, but I'm saying creative arts. I don't think you really think about it. I think it just, if you happen to like telling stories and you find that your stories, so for me it was, I like to make people laugh and I like to make people feel comfortable and I like to amuse them. So of course a lot of that comes from the books that I've read when I was a kid, and there's, you know, a lot of maybe the language, maybe the style of telling it, the format, the structure, whatever. It's great fun for me if I'm in a conversation and I'm telling a story and there are people reacting in the way that I want them to react. And that's extremely manipulative. I love doing that. I love manipulating the reactions of people around me. And that really is the first, whenever I do workshops and whenever I do any training, the first word that I write on the whiteboard is manipulation, because everyone, and even anyone who's watching this, if you want to be a storyteller, please be very, very aware of the fact that what you really want to do is manipulate your audience into a certain reaction. You want to get them to react in a certain way. So if I'm telling a funny story, I want them to laugh. If I'm telling a sad story, I want them to cry. If I want them to think about something, then I need to, you know. And then working backwards from that reaction, I need to know how to tell the story best, the way that I know how to tell it best. So if I am moved by something, then I would assume that it also moves other people. And then I test it out on a few people. So I think it's just storytelling, really. It's just telling. So storytelling includes telling jokes and includes telling legends and includes telling myths and includes telling anything, you know, telling a lie, really. You know, I think a lot of really good storytellers are very good liars, because they can get away with, yeah, they can just get away with saying a lie in such a way that it's credible. And it elicits a response. Like if I'm lying to someone and they can see through it, they'll be like, yaar, chalna kya hai. But if I'm lying to them and they don't know, if I say, you know, arey, meri mummy ko ye ho gaya, mere papa ko ye ho gaya, I know I'm like this and I'm like this, and they really feel that what I'm saying is true and they're moved by it because they're just nice human beings, I've gotten away with manipulating them. And I've found a way to sneak into their emotions and their hearts and activate their tear ducts and, you know, them feeling sad for me and sorry for me and hopefully donating to any charities that I want them to. But I'm just saying that there's...
So manipulating is also like a kind of an art. You have to learn it.
It is the art. It is the art.
It is the art.
I think every artist... No, it is. It's true. It sounds very, very harsh. It's. I don't mean it to be harsh. I mean, use manipulation in the word, literally what it means. It means to be able to twist someone's reactions the way that you want them to react, period. A painting can be a manipulation. So I don't know if you know the story of the Mona Lisa and why it became such a big painting. So it was not that big a deal. It just got stolen and restored. And so there's a whole story behind it. And then it just suddenly became this whole big deal in the world. And suddenly people started seeing it with this whole enigmatic smile. And is it a self-portrait? And, you know, all these different things which came out are all just stories, but they add to the mystery of just a tiny little canvas. It's not even that huge. It's just like this very medium-sized, you know, painting. Or if you see anything by Van Gogh, or you see anything by Picasso, or you see anything by a modern painter, you, whatever it elicits in you is what...
it's our interpretation.
That's also what the painter probably... But again, once you've done something, you've told a story and you've set it out in the world, you have no control on how it touches people in different ways, which is why there's a lot of content which can trigger people in a completely different way than what it was meant to be. And they're not necessarily wrong.
Yes.
It's their world experience and their life experience that has caused that reaction from them. So you have to be very ready with, you know, facing all kinds of reactions. So the really, really successful stories in any format, whether it's painting or it's writing or it's filmmaking or just stand-up comic telling a story or a TEDx talk, whatever it is, and these are all storytelling forms. The really successful ones are the ones which elicit exactly that reaction that the storyteller has wanted from the maximum people in the audience. And then that audience can be a global audience or just people sitting in a room and nobody else is hearing that story. It's like the electricity that went off in Bombay, you know, last week.
Yeah.
And we are so used to never having any power cuts that for us it was like, okay, you know, things that you take for granted. So manipulation for every storyteller is just taken for granted. Whether he or she thinks about it is a different matter. What you've literally just done is you've just suddenly... one light bulb has gone up and you've said,
yes, that's me right now.
Yeah,
manipulation. So
your first short film was made in 2002, Lucky Days. Then how did that happen, ma'am? I happened to watch it. It's a very, you know, wonderfully made short film. How did you manage to do that?
I don't really remember how. I don't really remember. Yeah, okay, so I mean, so what had happened was digital films had come into India, and the first digital film that was produced in India was a film called Urf Professor, which is a big underground cult. So it's still an underground cult. And my husband's a cinematographer, so he'd shot it, and then they were for the first time shooting on digital format. So a lot of other cinematographers were calling him and asking him about the formats and the cameras and how he did it and all this. And I'm sitting there listening to him, and I had a little baby, and I was trained from the institute.
Your son was 1 year old that time, right?
Yeah, one and a bit. Yeah. And I'd trained and I'd worked in the industry, I'd assisted and everything. And then I had this baby, and so I just became this mummy. And I'm feeling like meri to life khatam ho gayi abhi, like what am I even going to do? And then I'm hearing these, you know, he's constantly talking on the phone and saying, oh, this format, this format. And one minute, I have a DOP in the house who can shoot this. And my dad, you know, who's like quite indulgent, and I said, I'll just you know, muskow him and get some money from him. And we'll just make a film in 2 days. So it's like I just sat down and I wrote a story. I really, really don't remember how I got the idea for it. I just know that I just sat down and I wrote like some, you know, 12 pages of script or something. And Raghuveer Yadav was, who used to live in my building complex, so I had access to him. So I just, you know, met him and I said, yeah, ye please aap karenge. And he was like, yeah, cool. And I had to pay him like an X amount of money. It was very little. And all my friends are all technicians, so we literally shot in my parents' house and my grandmother's house, and you know that STD booth is my dad's STD booth, and everything was around, and we had like one baby light, so I say I had one baby and one baby on the set, so it was like just that, and then you know we just, I mean they literally, so Viju Khote is someone whom I knew because I'd worked with him on a film. And he recommended Usha Nadkarni, and then there was a couple of other actors who just kind of joined in. And I just made like my relatives stand in different places and sit in different places, and just there was nothing. And we just shot like for two shifts. It was literally 9 to 5 shoots. And then I didn't even cut it for a while. And then a friend of mine had an editing machine, so we just cut it there. And then another friend who was sending films abroad on something called Without a Box, which I think is going to either has already gone redundant or will go redundant now, but it's a festival platform where you can apply to festivals. So he told me about that, and we're all like very gareeb, right? So already at that time, there was no provision really in 2002 and 2003 to upload films and send it. I mean, the data and all at that time was like crazy. So slow. So we had to anyway send, you know, either, I mean, the smallest thing that we could send was a DVD copy or something. But usually I'd have to send like a mini DVD tape and actually courier it, which cost a bomb if you're sending it to America or to Australia or to France or whatever. So I would just write to all the festivals, which I recommend everyone to do, is asking for a waiver. And I'd just say, can you give me a waiver? And whoever gave me a waiver, I just submitted it there. So it got selected at some, I don't know, 15 odd festivals around the world. It had its world premiere in Australia at Brisbane, and it got screened at Female Eye, got screened at CineQuest, which is like a big shit then. I didn't know it was. I was like, okay, it's just going to different places. And I was very thrilled, and it got screened at the MIFF in Bombay as well, which I attended. And it was just like a fun thing that I did. And it kind of snowballed because then Anurag Kashyap saw it at a festival, and he kind of said, oh, this is like Hrishikesh Mukherjee filmmaking. And I was like, wow, because Hrishikesh Mukherjee is like one of my favorite directors.
Yeah.
And then of course, you know, it just, I think the generosity of people who are in the industry before you and who are bigger than you really, really goes a lot to support, you know, talent, which is new. I won't say younger talent, I just say newer talent.
New talent.
And that really helped. So I think my confidence just kind of grew, I think.
Yes, like Anurag Kashyap sir rightly pointed out to you, that was definitely a very well-made short film. Ma'am, I would like to ask you, like, when you started off in your career, how do you think a platform like One Page Spotlight would have helped you to, you know, kickstart or to, you know, help you to grow when you started off in your career? Because, you know, when someone starts off a career, it's somewhere people are usually lost and they're looking for some kind of help around them to connection. Connections, everything. So how do you think a platform like One Page Spotlight would have helped you?
Oh boy, I would have done everything then. No? Because I had a blog, and which I don't have anymore, but I should start now on this platform.
Definitely.
I had a blog, which was different, which is on somewhere else. And I was on something called Mandy.com, which is a platform which gives a lot of work opportunities to filmmakers and technicians around the world. But that doesn't really get into India. So to have something like that in India is fabulous.
Mm-hmm.
More transparent, of course. And I would have had, you know, immediate audience reactions as well. So I think it would have been so cool, yeah. But I guess it wasn't,
you have
it wasn't
now,
meant
ma'am.
To be then. I have it now. I know.
Yeah.
And I'm so envious of the youngsters who have it now too, because it's just something which, you know, which will really help them. It's like a shortcut. It's just something which you don't need to go through all the stuff that all of us went through. It's just so much easier to do things. And then you can use the rest of your time and energy more productively.
Yeah.
If you have everything in one place and, you know, you're focused that this is the one app on which my films are and my network is and my job opportunities
Definitely.
Are coming out of.
That is amazing, ma'am. I hope I can see your blog soon. And for everyone who's watching this, if you're into filmmaking or if you're into acting, I think a portfolio plays a very important role. And portfolio is a feature in One Page Spotlight, and we make it very easy for you to create a portfolio. Like ma'am said, you know, these days it's very times everything, and we've made it super easy with the portfolio feature, where you can put in all your information from your photographs to your YouTube links, and you know, keep them in one place and share it. And I'm sure, you know, if a producer or a director like ma'am, you can send it as one single link. And I would suggest you all to sign up on One Page Spotlight and definitely take a look in onto a portfolio feature and to use it.
Especially with directors, I think when they want to see actors' work, it's really cool. And of course, also to see technicians' work, but usually technicians, you know, you work with people you know and stuff, but actors are always looking for newer faces and new talents. So
definitely, ma'am, totally. And I'm looking forward to reading your blogs soon on our platform.
Yeah, I don't know how frequent it'll be, but thank you.
So
to all the writers out there, we also have a blog, so I would request you all to, you know, go look up our website. And we also have an app right now where you can download it in Play Store and also in App Store. So you can download our app, or you can go and, you know, look up at our website, and you can create your own blog. And even ma'am's going to write her blog very soon. I'm waiting to read them already. So ma'am, how did the short film Plus Minus happen to you? And, you know, how did you connect a stubborn woman to, you know, a legend of Harbhajan Baba? How did that happen, ma'am?
So that's very clear. There's a very, very clear story to how Plus Minus story came into my head. So Divya Tata is a very dear friend of mine, and somebody wanted her to do a short film. She reached out to me saying, hey, do you have an idea? And I had no idea. And I'd done Chutney, and Chutney was this crazy hit, and it was like going viral, and I was like, what am I going to do even? You know, it's like you've got this humongous, and then everyone's kind of waiting that it's a flash in the pan, you know, it's a fluke. God knows, aise pata nahi kahan se kaun aa gaya bana raha hai. So although I know how hard we worked on it, but the thing is that you know you never know. People are just waiting for you to make a mistake. So that's something else which I think youngsters need to realize, that don't be too complacent if you've had one big success, because there's a ton of people just waiting for you to mess up, and then they'll be like, yes, see, we told you. But I told Divya, I'm not sure, yeah, you know. And I have these team of young people who work with me, and they're like assistants and collaborators. So I just happen to tell them, if you get a good story, let me know. So I'm sitting in my cabin one day, and one of the kids comes in, and he gets tagged in almost every plus minus post because of him. This story came. So he said, "Ma'am, aapko Harbhajan Singh pata hai?" So I said, "Haan, wo cricketer." And he said, "Nahi, aap Google karo Harbhajan Singh Army." So I just turned, so I was in this chair, and I turned my chair, and my laptop's there, and I Google Harbhajan Singh Army, and of course the whole Baba Harbhajan Singh stories, you know, the links start popping up in Wikipedia and everything. And from the time that I turned around and I sat and I was researching, in 2 hours, I had the entire screenplay down with dialogue, which is the film that you see today.
Wow. Just in 2 hours. You did it all in two hours.
So I didn't do it. So it was, I completely take no credit for it. I love the credit for it. I love having my name as writer. It's completely fake, because it's the universe who just, you know, just cracked my cranium and threw my nerve cells into my fingers. I just was typing.
Was it Harbhajan Singh, ma'am?
I think it's more actually. So I had also lost my mom-in-law very suddenly. Before that, and I was still grieving, and I was very, very close to her, very close to her. So for me, I think that grief, along with this crazy story, so which is why also in plus minus, there's a card which I put right in the front remembering Bo. So Bo is mother in Odia. So I really had to give her credit for that, because I think she just, you know, she just kind of used her influence in whatever space there is, and it's complete divine whatever. I don't know what it is yet. It's inspiration, and I really, really cannot take credit for that, but I'm just blessed that I was the medium to tell that story, which was so crazy, because it's like you're saying, it's patriotic, and I'm amazed. I mean, every time I'm watching it, and I'm watching it like a complete outsider. You know, I'm reacting to it like it's stupid, right? Because you're the person who's made the film. But every time I watch it, and the last time I watched it on the big screen was again at MIFF. So they screened Plus Minus as well in early this year, in Jan or Feb. And in the films division, and I'm watching it on the screen, and I'm watching it like an audience. I'm watching it, and I'm reacting to it, and I'm feeling bad, and I'm smiling, and I'm whatever, and I'm thinking, is this like weird, because I know this whole film, I've made this film, but so I wouldn't take any credit for it.
Plus Minus was also part of our film festival in One Page Spotlight. It was called Spotlight Shorts. We had around 53 short films in 11 different languages. I request you all, everyone, whoever is watching this, to, you know, go ahead and watch, join our community in the Spotlight Shorts community, and just binge watch all the amazing short films we've curated for you. So how do you think, you know, film festivals like this would help filmmakers and artists around the world?
No, I think it's fabulous. I mean, I'm just... You know, I just love seeing the kind of content that comes on. There's all kinds of voices. There's all kinds of... So I think it's great if you're giving all kinds of filmmakers a chance to tell their stories and, you know, be there. You know, they can actually see the kind of responses that their films get. Mm-hmm. It's amazing. I mean, it's, you know, I think online is really the way to go. Even after things settle down, it's fun to have people from everywhere just connect to your film just via the internet.
Ma'am, I would like to know, how did this short film Chutney happened to you. It won, that was your first short in the short film industry after a break, I would say, after 2002, where you were behind a lot of blockbuster movies, where you were the creative head of movies like Kahani, Queen, Baag Milka Baag, Margarita with a Straw, and a lot more. But as a short film maker, I would say that was your first break, and that's one of the best short films I've watched personally. And also I would like to ask you, how did that short film happen to you?
So that's so it's a short story by Rishal Sahani ji, who's he's a Hindi novelist and short story writer. Mm-hmm. And it's a story called Sadmeet. It's a short story, which is a monologue of this middle-aged woman who's talking about servants and stuff. So it's And Diska Chopra used to perform that character, that same story, that same monologue in theater. And she would make herself up as a middle-aged woman and she would do this. So she wanted to make it as a short film, and we decided to contemporize it. And we also wrote to Bhisham Sahni's daughter, who's mm-hmm. his heir, and she had to give permission and whether she wanted any monies for it, or we had to negotiate for that. But she was very generous and she just said, you guys are changing it, so just take it. And we don't even want credit. But again, I wanted to put Remembering Bhisham Sahni, because it's just fair to give credit to the original storyteller. True. And also, to cover my backside, because I know a lot of people would recognize the story. So if you scroll through the YouTube
section.
There are people are saying ye to wo story hai, and then there are like 20 people defending me, saying credit diya hua hai. So it's kind of I knew it's gonna happen, so it's just easier to just give credit and say and it's a legit it's all legit. So she wanted to, so I wrote a screenplay, which is the film. And Tiska worked on her character, and we had these, we had a language coach who was very good. He's from NSD and he's a brilliant actor director, and Avnish Mishra. And he suggested a lot of lines, and he suggested, because of the language, he said, there are certain things that you can say, that sargaram pair naram pet thanda, that all that. So Dr.
Yes.
Kumaru Danda, all that is him. And so I wanted to give him credit as a writer on the film as well. Mm-hmm. And then also because Tiska worked on her character and she was, fine-tuning what, because really the whole film is really her monologue. It's that character's, it's her voice really throughout the entire, 18 odd minutes, 16, 17 minutes.
18.49.
Yeah, so I forgot how much it was, but yeah. And she wanted some credit as well, so we I was quite happy to get that. And we went, and then I did like a PPT which was sent to Large Short Films, and they commissioned the film. We went to shoot, and nobody at that time thought, none of us thought, we all shot, it was a short film, so we all worked for free, first of all of us. So we just wanted to make the film. We wanted whatever money's come, we wanted to go into shooting. So we went to Delhi to shoot. So of course, people are taking flights and they're staying there. And so there's all these expenses. And although I was not privy to the production at all, but the thing is that we just worked and nobody thought, I didn't think, I don't know whether anyone did or not, but we just had like a great time telling the story, shooting it, and edited it and then put it out, and it just started going viral. And then serendipitously, the whole film fair thing happened that year. The first time that they had this whole shorts thing, and then Chutney won, and it was just magical, I think. Just
yes.
Like you rightly said, ma'am, previously that, and it's all about interpretation, it's all about manipulation in art. And your short film Chutney, every single time I watch it, I've watched it like 10 different times, and every time I watch it, I get a different perspective. And that is the most, interesting part of this short film, I would say. And ma'am, I have this one question for you. I would want to know, how do you brief your actors? How does that happen? And do you like usually follow a pattern that you use for all the actors, or you brief them differently, or you just let them be and just tell them this is what should be done and go about it?
A lot of the times when I write, I know I can hear the whole film and I can see the whole film, so I know that this is how this character should sound and this is the pause that should take, and I'm a bit of a control freak, so I kind of know exactly what has to be done. Plus minus was very non-negotiable that way. I didn't even, you know, usually when you write a story, it's good to bounce it off a few people and get their reactions and all. For me, because plus minus was so organic, so in, you know, crazily organic, I didn't want to share that story with anyone. I didn't want to get anyone's reactions. I didn't want anyone giving any suggestions, nothing. And I'm very aware of that. Luckily, also the few people whom I narrated the story to, the very, very few people, including my producers and some, you know, critics who are well-wishers, people who are film critics for many years and they know about content. Everybody gave a very, very happy, positive reaction, exactly what I would have wanted, what my ego as a writer, as well as a filmmaker and all that would have wanted. You know? Mm-hmm. I'm not saying really ego. That your ego gets fed when you get a good reaction from someone. The minute people start saying, "Arey," then you go like, you get very defensive. So I was very happy, but I didn't want to share it with too many people. And when I also briefed Divya and Bhuvan about it, it was very clear. This is how. So I did. So Divya didn't really need a workshop because she's an actor anyway. We had a couple of reading sessions. Not even workshops, we just did readings. Mm-hmm. And with Bhuvan, though, I did like a workshop, proper workshop with him, because that was the first time he was going to really perform in another character, which is not like a YouTube video kind of a thing, you know, where just he just says a line, cuts it, goes to another character, which he's only playing. So this was completely a new experience for Bhuvan, and he was fabulous. I mean, just he gave his all, and he, you know, put in his 180%, just went into it. And on the shoot also, he was constantly observing everything. He was looking at how we were working, how Divya was performing, all that was going on. So it was great. And that was one experience. In Chutney, again, Rasika is a junior from the FTI. She's an actor. Yeah. Again, she's done brilliant work. So I needed that chemistry between Rasika and Tiska. So we did workshops at Avnish's theater group premises. So they, you know, I shot that. I knew how they would be sitting. I knew their body language. So I made them do that because they had to be a very, so Rasika, when she's sitting, has to be trapped, you know. Mm-hmm. So in the charpai, she's sitting cross-legged in that charpai.
Yeah. Whereas
Tiska's, you know, one leg will be down and she can keep moving, and you know, she still has that freedom to move around.
Yeah.
She's not trapped at all. So mm-hmm. there was that's very important. That was very, very, I was very clear even when I was writing it down. That's how their body language has to be. Because like when I'm writing, I can see how they're gonna look and what's gonna happen. So we had to do that with them. Adil, I literally met on set. So that mm-hmm. was really wild because I'd not met him before. I'd met the other Delhi actors. So I'd met Sumit and Akash earlier before the shoot in Delhi. But Adil I met on set. Mm-hmm. So it was crazy. But he's such a lovely person and such a good actor that he just, and he has no, I mean, he'll ask you relevant questions about his character, but he just never second guessed what I was telling him. It's just so respectful for two people who are collaborating to have that kind of professional relationship where an actor just comes with 100% faith in the director's conviction and says, "Aap mere ko bataiye, how should I do it? Should I play it like this? Should I play it like this?" Or sometimes I would act it out and I would show it to him. And he was very, very easy. I mean, it was just this. It was, I just can't wait to get back to working with Adil Hussain. He's brilliant.
I recently happened to read that, you know, that you're going to make a short, not a short film, a biopic on Baba Harbhajan Singh this time. And when is it happening? When can we watch your film, ma'am?
I don't know what is happening. I've got the script ready.
Wow, okay.
Again, there's a dear friend of mine who, so I have these, you know, angels in my life, which is kind of, so this friend of mine who just, you know, he saw Class Minus and he said, you know, why don't we make it into a feature? And I'm like, it's okay, Anna, what are you doing? You've told a story and it's over. But then we, you know, he's like, don't just give it, you know, it's a short film and there's so much potential in this character. Yeah. And he basically, you know, inspired me to start thinking about what we could do with it. So Harbhajan Singh is one character in the film and there's another fictional character in the film. So who's a girl who's really the protagonist, and it's her journey and he's with her. And that's about all I can tell you right now. But it's I'm hoping it'll be a, you know, I love patriotic films, I love emotional films, and I love love stories. So if I can possibly put that together in a film, it works, and you know, the audience doesn't say kya hai, but they like it, it would be super. So right now we've got a script ready, we're putting the cast together in place, and of course this stupid, you know, coronavirus has come and ruined our lives completely. But the thing is that we just, you know, maybe everything happens for the best. So let's see. You know, we'll know who's in it, and that's really the producer's prerogative to give out the details. But yeah, but I'm very excited. And
ma'am, I happen to read that action's your favorite genre. And when are we going to watch an action film directed by you, ma'am?
No, that was I think. So there was a film that was offered to me, which I was supposed to be doing, and that was an action film. And I do like action. It's not my favorite genre.
Mm-hmm.
It's a genre I like. It was going to be fun to do. Unfortunately, I didn't do that film. And, mm-hmm. You know, we just parted ways, and the producer did it, you know, differently. And I was looking at it in a very different way. And so in that whole, you know, the producer's PR exercise, it came out that actually my favorite. I was like,
yeah.
Okay, so it's I'm not, which is why I'm like very, very wary of all this PR stuff. Like, let my film come out and let it speak for itself, and that's okay then.
In today's day and age, how important do you think social media is?
Especially in times like this.
No, very important. Of course, you need to be, but you can't be in an echo chamber. You need to be open to all kinds of views. You need to be open to even opinions that are different from yours. I know I'm very shocked when I find certain people, especially younger people, who will not read an article because it's come in a certain publication. You know, they'll say, iska hai, ye yahan pe aaya tha, so we're not even going to read that article. You've already dismissed. So for me, it is the opposite. I'm like, I want to read what somebody else whom I don't really trust, but what are they saying about it? So I get to see the opposite point of view, and maybe it changes my point of view, or maybe I can find something which refutes it, so it makes my view or my opinion stronger.
Mm-hmm.
But you need that perspective, you know, if you're in an echo chamber, it's... But of course, you need social media. I mean, especially when people are locked up in their houses, and
definitely.
If there are, you know, there are people who live away from their families, and there's so much loneliness. It's scary to even think of that. How do they, you know? It's really, really scary.
For all the artists out there, if you're, you know, just scribbling about the lockdown, don't do that. You know, this is the right time to get on to social media, get on to One Page Spotlight, create something, share it with the world. So for all the artists out there, stop cribbing, start creating. Ma'am, you are among the few women directors in the film industry. And do you think there's any kind of bias?
Uh-huh.
There's no bias. Everybody has their own workspace and whatever. So it's like, I don't even remember half the time I'm a woman. So I don't know what this whole woman thing is about. you get an idea, anyone can get an idea. You like certain content, everybody can like all kinds of content. So it's not, I don't believe at all in, you know, in the fact that, oh, I'm a woman, so I should make a certain mm-hmm. kind of film and all. I'm a filmmaker and I should make engaging content. That's definitely. It. There's no bigger sin than being boring. Mm-hmm. So if you're going to be preachy and it's going to be boring, then like, please, you know, just get out of my face. And if you're fun and you're wicked and you're whatever, and you still get away with telling something out of that, then why not? And it doesn't, I mean, today everyone's consuming all kinds of content. I don't look to see, oh, has a woman produced this or has, you know, somebody else done something. I don't know. I'm not thinking of it like that.
Ma'am, these days there are a lot of like controversies around Bollywood, and you know, you're an outsider yourself, and you know, what is that one advice that you would want to give newcomers or the, you know, people who are just trying to start off? So what is that one advice that you would want to give them?
I don't consider myself an outsider simply because I've been here for 30 odd years. Mm-hmm. So I'm really not, I mean, I'm older than most of the people who are trying to get in now. So
when you got in,
I don't think so. Yeah, if you can work and you can, and you have a thick skin and you don't take things personally, I think it's okay. You don't need to, I mean, it's basic, right? If my father has a shop, mm-hmm. and, you know, I mean, he's not going to go looking in the market to see my dukaan kisko do na, they'll give it to me, you know. Or I had friends who were dentist kids in my class, and they all became dentists and they inherited their parents' practice and yeah. their parents' patients and their kids. Mm-hmm. So I don't agree with you know, nepotism. Yes, I agree that there are people who get more chances than they ought to, but that is, I mean, just we are the ones, you know, as audiences, we are the ones who are giving, who are feasting on people's private lives, who's hooked up with whom and whose boyfriend is whom and why did they break up. And I mean, just see the kind of stuff that so many platforms are just thriving on. There are so many people are employed because of all this, you know, yeah. this whatever journalism, yeah, filmy journalism of whatever sorts. I'm not even going to take names, but there's so many platforms which are up there. They probably don't even have offices. They just have a website and people are working out of home and getting paid. And they're just picking up like random stuff off Instagram stories and Instagram posts and Facebook posts and tweets and trying to see 2 + 2 = 22 or 222. I don't know what. So I'm okay. Like, theek hai na, matlab kisi ki rozi roti chal rahi hai on speculation. But then it needs to work both ways. No, you can't start abusing people just because it's really strange. So also there's something known as not taking things personally. Like if I have one role in my film, I'm taking a chance of offending 100 actors because I choose one actor to play that role. I can't tell people all 100, you all come and do. Someone or the other is going to get mad at me. Someone's going to think, "Arey, she knows this person pehle se, or they're related to her, or they're friends with her, or she's doing him a favor or her a favor." Someone or the other is always going to think something like this.
I totally agree with what you say, ma'am. That was very well put. Ma'am, what is that one, you know, advice that you would want to give aspiring filmmakers? I would want to ask you a lot more questions, but you know, because of the time constraint, and I know how busy you are as a person, so I will have to wrap it up. This is your last question. I can't thank you enough for being so, you know, lively and answering all my questions. So this is, you know, this is something that all our viewers would love to hear from you. So what is that one advice that you would want to give filmmakers, aspiring writers, and also, you know, actors?
Please write from your heart. If you don't believe in what you're writing, you can't convince anyone.
It was an amazing conversation with Jyoti Kapoor, ma'am. I can't thank you enough. Thank you. Thanks a lot for being a part of this interaction. I learned a lot personally, and I'm sure even our viewers learned a lot. So it was great having you with us, and especially the manipulation part. I never thought of manipulation being so important. Thanks again, ma'am. Thanks for taking time out of your busy schedule.
Thank you. Thank you. I need it. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Bye. And for all the viewers who are watching this, I would request you all to sign up on One Page Spotlight to watch more interviews and interactions and amazing to connect and to meet amazing artists. One Page Spotlight is the place for you. If you ever wanted to make your passion your profession, then you are in the right place. Don't waste your time. Go ahead, sign up on One Page Spotlight. We also have an app. You can download it both on Play Store and on App Store. Go ahead, download, keep creating. Until we meet next time, yours, Shubhashri Rajendran.
Download the One Page Spotlight app for artists. Download the One Page Spotlight app for artists.